So as Beyonce said, you know, who runs the world? If you listen to the song closely, it's girls. And you know, if you listen to it very closely, like I've done, because I'm a super fan, it's also algorithms. But you have to listen to it very closely, okay? Next time, try it. And this is a very apt phrase, right? Because algorithms are everywhere, and they interact in our lives in very silent ways that we don't even realize. So anytime you use like a map software to go from point A to point B, it's actually running an algorithm in the background to give you provably the fastest route, for example, to go from MIT to go watch the Red Sox play in Fenway. We also use them to understand the internet. Like, for example, you know, which 100 websites were the most visited last month, and so on. And maybe more importantly, we use algorithms to understand us and how we live and how we behave. For example, you know, how many people in this room have the cold or, you know, some other disease and so on. So we use them to compute fundamental things about us. And the nice things about algorithms is that we can optimize them for like various resources that we care about. So for example, when you're using a map software, you want the map to load fast, right? Like you don't want to wait there forever. When you're analyzing, you know, information about the web and the internet, you might not have enough space to store everything. And when you want to answer questions about humans, it might not be possible to, you know, ask a question to every individual. So there's different resources that we care about when we design algorithms. So now in the world that I come from, I work mostly in the math behind algorithms. We mostly care about the gold standard, which is provable guarantees, aka mathematical correctness. And what that means is we always want the right answer. So for example, you know, when you, it's even very trivial examples, when you go through your mail and you sort the mails by, you know, the mails that came in the by date, you want the sorting to be correct, right? And so this is usually called worst case guarantees, or we want to have worst case guarantees. And this makes sense, right? Like these algorithms are run every day by millions of people all around the world, and we don't know, you know, what they're gonna ask for. So we want it to be correct. For example, if I'm going from MIT to Fenway or MIT to Copley, I want the right answer, meaning I want the shortest way to get there no matter what. So some of the work that I've been working on in my PhD is a new paradigm to look at how we design algorithms. So the main motivation behind it is that we design algorithms for similar tasks every day. For example, if we're, you know, creating train schedules to train schedules of how people move, or bus schedules and so on, these things don't change much day to day, right? Like same types of people wanna go from point A to point B. So the idea was, can we leverage this information that we know from the past or from any other data that we have to actually change the algorithm design process itself? So we want this like feedback loop between data and algorithm design. What that means, like let's be more specific, is can we look at the inputs or the instances that we've run the algorithm in the past and extract patterns and other information out of it to help seed our algorithm or warm start our algorithm or even change the algorithm design itself so that it's better tailored to the patterns that we observe in the inputs that we actually run it on. Okay. So to give you a very concrete example, let's say that most people from MIT, like, they want to, you know, in the weekends, they always want to go south. So if you're a map software, or, you know, Google Maps, how can you take advantage of this? So one thing that you can do is you can say, okay, I know that 90% of people always want to go south. So first, I'll just load the part of the map that corresponds to that direction, and I'll search that direction first. And if it's actually true that 90% of people want to go south, then we'll end up finding our shortest route much faster than if we've loaded the whole map beforehand. And this saves valuable time and computational resources. So to put things in a more like principled standing, we want two desirable properties of these learning augmented algorithms. First, we kind of want that if our predictions are accurate or if we've sort of leveraged the right patterns in the inputs that we've seen in the past, then we can actually get better algorithms in terms of resources. Like, for example, if we kind of have a hint about which 100 websites are probably going to be the most popular because they were popular a month ago, and we want to calculate that today, then this might help us better allocate the space that we have to store the internet data to better analyze it and get better answers. But we also, you know, at least me, I don't want to leave the gold standard behind. Like, I still want mathematical correctness, even if the predictions are not correct. AKA, you know, in this map example, right, let's say I don't want to go south, that I want to go north, I still want to be able to find the fastest way to get there. So some of my contributions in this sort of new field have been on working on, like, foundational problems in this area to design algorithms that have this best of both worlds guarantees, that we can get better algorithms if our predictions that we've learned, for example, using machine learning models on past input are correct, but we still have mathematical guarantees that if the predictions are wrong, we still get these gold standard behaviors that we care about. So for example, you know, I've worked on faster algorithms on graphs, like computing shortest paths that have this flavor. I've worked on answering statistical questions that require much fewer data from individuals if we know sort of the processes behind, or if we have hints about the processes behind that are generating this data. I've also worked on interesting problems on, you know, how can we query a large model like ChatGPT-4 very few times to get the same quality of answers, because, you know, every query costs money, right? So we want to minimize that. For example, can we use the queries that we've seen in the past or queries from a cheaper model that may be free to help us better utilize our query budget for large models and better space solutions? For example, like I said, if I know that Google is probably going to be one of my top 100 most visited websites, do I really need to count or store data about Google when I want to analyze, you know, what are the current top 100 visited websites and so on? So I guess looking more towards the future, this is a very new area, at least in the algorithms world. And it's new because we really don't want to, we want to take a more principled approach of, you know, having both provable guarantees while also taking advantage of all the great and exciting progress that we're making in the machine learning world. And at least in my belief, they have, like, potential for enormous impact, right? If we can save computational budget, right? For example, we can at least contribute to, or not contribute so much to climate change. And the nice kind of interesting thing about this space that it's not a one-size-fits-all approach. Like, we really have to look at the problem that we want to solve. For example, you know, finding the shortest paths, or, you know, planning the best bus routes and so on, and see, like, what can we leverage about this combinatorial problem or you know, optimization problem? What can we leverage about it so that we can insert, you know, hints or predictions from a machine learning model in a way such that we actually also can guarantee worst case bounds, even if the predictions are wrong. So yeah, feel free to contact me. And also, you know, this is a very long day with lots of great talks, so, you know, don't, you know, also stretch sometimes like these cute animals. Yeah, and thank you so much for listening.